The next case I find interesting not for the policy reasons, but because it doesn't stick to the pro forma of going in going to the limiting the stuff. So the previous cases we saw, the case with Bulova, the robbery took place within the airport. So it took place within the airport, JFK airport itself. Cargo Amerford, another case, and many of you may be familiar, especially those who do business in New York. Cargo Amerford case, on the other hand, took place. It wasn't a robbery, but loss of the cargo took place outside of the airport grounds. It took place next to the JFK, but it didn't take place right on the airport ground. So this case serves as a testament of the Montreal Convention applicability outside of the airport. So let's take a look what's going on here. So we have the air freight forwarder, in this case, it's not an import, it's an export. And here we have the IBM transporting its goods to Hong Kong. So it went, and it was supposed to be transported by Japan Airlines, and it was cargo Amerford's facility near JFK Airport. So it wasn't on the JFK Airport, but it was near. Amerford employees preparing the Japan Airlines flight could not locate the carton, so it was lost or stolen, in other words. And NYPD, neither NYPD nor FBI could really figure out what's going on. So what's the question? What's the dollar amount here? Remember that 17 special drawing rights provision? Well, the dollar question here, again, this is predecessor Warsaw Convention, but the difference in liability is huge. So if the convention applies, it's $1,300. If it doesn't, it's almost $100,000. So it's very crucial for the freight forwarder to really establish its liability under the convention, because the difference is huge. I'm not even going to say percentages in this case. So what this case eventually went on and applied the Montreal fine Montreal Convention applicable to the cargo Amerford, but it found it applicable on a multi-factor test. So number one, it went on to say that cargo Amerford holds itself out as the air freight forwarder and indirect air carrier. Let me see if I can find it right here. So that's one factor. So how you hold yourself out? So here, what I think is critical, and this is another factor which we need to put on the law. How you hold yourself out? It's the appearance, if you will, of holding out as freight forwarder, right? Do you have IATA certification, for example? Do you hold yourself out as a freight forwarder to the public? What's going on? Well, this is a pre-internet days, but what does your website say? So all those factors are relevant to finding applicability of the Montreal Convention. Next, The fact is listed. The course goes on to apply the DHL case, and within the DHL case, it goes on to say, well, what's going on with the conduct of business? Did you make profit? All right. How you made profit? What is the history of dealings between the parties? So those are the factors which are also relevant. So it's not only holding yourself out per se, but really is also talks about the history of dealings. And how you make your money. So business model. So okay. So business model itself. So what we see here and why are we doing this list is because with this list we can. Is your business model like the one that is applicable to the freight forwarder or indirect area carrier? If it is, then it's a factor. So the cargo Amerford case stands for the proposition that the Montreal Convention should be applicable based on the totality of circumstances, or what they call as a multi-factor test.